And there's not much in olive oil that's healthy. And nuts are highly addicting. Once you start eating nuts, you don't stop. And I think you've got the title wrong. The title should be The Creation of Cardiovascular Disease with the Mediterranean Diet.
Dr. Caldwell Esselstyn is a physician, author, and Olympic gold medalist. He's the director of the Esselstyn Heart Disease Program at the Cleveland Clinic, where patients with heart disease are advised to follow a plant-based, very low-fat diet. His book, Prevent and Reverse Heart Disease, is a New York Times bestseller. I recently spoke with Dr. Esselstyn. We had different views on a couple of topics, which made for a really interesting conversation. We're working really hard on getting the full interview edited and packaged for release. In the meantime, here's a section where we talk about dietary fat, oil, and heart disease. Enjoy.
So, what are the foods that every time they pass our lips, we injure the endothelium? They are, one, any drop of oil, olive oil, corn oil, soybean oil, safflower oil, sunflower oil, coconut oil, palm oil, oil in a cracker, oil in a chip, oil in a piece of bread, oil in a salad dressing. Do you, Joe, ever eat oil? All right, we got that out of the way. Next, we got to get rid of your animal protein. Meat, fish, chicken, fowl, turkey, and eggs. How are you doing on that? Okay. Also, we want to get rid of dairy, milk, cream, butter, cheese, ice cream, and yogurt. Okay. Also, we want to be careful about sugary drinks, Diet Cokes, Pepsi, and Coke, and sugary foods. Cakes, pies, cookies, stevia, agave, excesses of maple syrup, molasses, and honey. Also, I don't like peanuts, peanut butter, nut butters, cashew sauce, or avocado. And finally, coffee with caffeine. Decaf, yes. Coffee with caffeine, no. Injures endothelial cells. Now, what are you going to eat? What are you going to eat? All these marvelous whole grains for your cereal, bread, pasta, rolls, and bagels. 101 different types of legumes, lentils, and beans. All these marvelous red, yellow, green leafy vegetables. White potatoes, sweet potatoes, and some fruit. Now, I should share with you that about a decade ago, I made a major change in the program. And that change came about from a recognition of the fact that the endothelial production of nitric oxide is age dependent. So, for example, you never heard of a boy or a girl at age 8 having a heart attack, right? No, they have nitric oxide coming out of their ears. But by the time they're 50 and beautifully healthy, their endothelial production of nitric oxide is now 50% of what it was when you were 25. Now, when you're 80, you've lost 70%. So the changes I made were two. One, a greater stimulation of the endothelial production of nitric oxide. And number two, we embraced the newer research that shows us that mankind has an alternate pathway for making additional nitric oxide. So here we go. I need you to chew 6 times a day a green leafy vegetable, approximately 1/3 of a cup, after it has first been steamed or boiled, 5.5 to 6 minutes, so it's nice and tender, and then you must anoint it with several drops of a delightful balsamic or rice vinegar. Why? Because research has shown us that the acetic acid from those vinegars can restore the nitric oxide synthase enzyme contained within the endothelial cell and responsible for making nitric oxide. So, you're going to chew this alongside your breakfast cereal. Again, as a mid-morning snack. Again, with your lunch and sandwich, that's 3. Mid-afternoon, 4. Dinner time, 5. And I adore it when you have that evening snack of arugula or kale. Now, the second benefit. When you're chewing the green leafy vegetable, you are restoring the capacity of your bone marrow to make your capacity of your bone marrow to replace our senescent, injured, worn out endothelial cells. The third benefit, When you're chewing a green leafy vegetable, you are chewing a green nitrate. As you chew the green nitrate, it is going to mix with the facultative anaerobic bacteria that reside in the crypts and grooves of your tongue. Those bacteria will reduce the nitrate you've been chewing to a nitrite. When you swallow the nitrite, it is your own gastric acid, which is now going to reduce the nitrite to more nitric oxide, which can enter your nitric oxide pool. So think about it. What you're doing for minimal expense and no hideous side effects, all day long, dawn to dusk, morning to night, you are absolutely replacing the very molecule, nitric oxide, the deficiency of which gave you this disease in the first place. Now, there's a caveat to this. Toothpaste with fluoride, public drinking water with fluoride, and mouthwash will injure the beneficial bacteria in your mouth. And I do not like antacids because antacids will reduce your gastric acidity and you will be unable to reduce the nitrite to more nitric oxide. And I do not know. And I want to share with you the top six vegetables would be kale, Swiss chard, spinach, arugula, beet greens, and beets. If you want the whole list,
Go for it.
Swiss chard, kale, collard greens, beet greens, mustard greens, turnip greens, napa, cabbage, Brussels sprouts, broccoli, cauliflower, cilantro, parsley, spinach, and arugula and asparagus. The reason I go through that like that for you is you have to know how whole food plant-based nutrition can restore your memory.
I don't think anybody doubts your memory capacity.
I'm sorry to be so long, but that's what I just gave you is part and parcel of what I do with the patient.
So with oil, that there's a lot of questions on oil, but I just want to understand the recommendation to avoid all forms of oil. What is the pillar or pillars of data that led you to this conclusion?
I wrote a paper called Is Oil Healthy? That was published in the International Journal of Disease Reversal and Prevention in 2019. Half of the paper was I reviewed the animal studies that injure endothelial cells, and I reviewed the human studies I found, and that showed that animals, the protein, excuse, that oil would injure endothelial cells. And I cited with the appropriate references.
So this is one of the main arguments that I've heard, this idea that after eating, for example, olive oil, flow-mediated dilation is inhibited postprandially. This is one of the arguments that it then damages the endothelium, and so we should avoid oil. This is the gist of the argument.
Well, there's a paper in there that very clearly it shows how olive oil, palm oil, and others injure endothelial cells. That was one of the major papers. And there was a large Spanish study that PREDIMED. The PREDIMED study, and I can remember. There was a reporter from the New York Times after the paper came out that called me and said, "Dr. Esselstyn, this seems to disagree with your philosophy. What do you think of it?" And the paper, and I said, "Well, I said I hadn't seen it." So she sent it to me, and I said, "The title of the paper is The Mediterranean Diet Inhibits Formation of Heart Disease." They have three groups: an oil group, a nut group, and then a low-fat group that was not low-fat at all. And over the course of 5 years, in these 5,000, I think it was 5,000 patients, they found that in the oil group, I forget, it was something like 80, 85 to 86 major events, something like 93 in the nut group. And then, of course, in the low-fat group, which was not a low-fat group, it was like 100 and something. So I said, "Now, I want to be sure I because I talked to her on the phone." I said, "They're claiming that the Mediterranean diet halts the progression of heart disease, but remember, every single patient who entered that study had to be checked and be sure that they did not have any heart disease. So, in other words, they were documented as not having heart disease. And what I found is, in all three groups, there had been scores of major cardiac events, heart attack, stroke, and death. And I think you've got the title wrong. The title should be The Creation of cardiovascular disease with the Mediterranean diet.
The events could be from plaque that is already there from before. But yeah,
Well,
it's
still, when you start and you make the premise or you declare that nobody has symptomatic or cardiovascular disease they could identify and enter into the study, and then suddenly scores of patients in each category come down with major events. And that's why I objected to the title.
Yeah, I understand what you're saying. I don't know if I would say that it's the diet they were on during the trial that's causing that, but it certainly seems to be a very partial effect. I agree with, I know what you're saying. It's just a partial reduction, and they're still having all these events that ideally we would want to avoid. I agree with that. So whether that's because the compliance was not great or whether it's because of something else, it's hard to say, but it's an interesting point that you're making. With the FMD data, I just wanted to bring up a couple of things that I found that I've never seen kind of discussed. I found that the effect on flow-mediated dilation seems to depend on the type of fat. So with olive oil, they see this inhibition right after eating olive oil. But for example, with canola oil, no statistically significant effect on FMD. Eating fish, no significant effect on FMD. Eggs also. So I basically the as I was going through this kind of systematically, this postprandial effect seems to depend a lot on the type of fat. It doesn't seem to be a consistent effect of fat depressing FMD. That was one thing that I noticed. And then another thing that I thought was even more interesting was that it depends on the timing. So lots of things seem to affect FMD kind of acutely. After exercise, they see FMD be depressed, but then long term, exercise improves artery function. And with olive oil, the same pattern. After a meal, we see FMD inhibited, but long term, in several trials, they see FMD improving on olive oil interventions. So it just seemed to me that the FMD argument was not very compelling based on the evidence that I've seen.
Well, isn't olive oil something like 17% saturated fat?
14, I think.
Yeah.
But is
And
it?
so these poor people who are vegans are thriving on, and not all brands of olive oil are the same.
Sure. There's probably differences there.
And maybe some of them have more than 14%.
It's possible. But
Yeah.
is it? Yeah.
They don't, and there's not much in olive oil that's healthy.
Well, I don't know about that. There's studies comparing with polyphenols and all these other components that suggest that those have beneficial effects. Also, the unsaturated fats, right? If the ratio of unsaturated to saturated is huge for unsaturated fats. So it has 14% saturated, but the rest is all unsaturated. It's all monos and polys, mostly monos.
I have to go back to where my basic causation is, it does injure endothelial cells.
The other thing that kind of threw me off, I thought you had changed your mind on olive oil because of that review that came out in JACC in 2017.
No, whenever you are writing with a group, you make compromises. I felt so badly about this, but I was so outvoted, or else they were going to throw me off the paper, which I probably should have done.
Got it. Just to clarify why. People at home that might not know what I'm talking about, it's a review in JACC that recommends olive oil where you're an author. But yeah, that makes sense that there was a bit of some negotiation and ended up being a paper that recommends olive oil.
That's a nice way of saying
Yeah, a fight in the background.
it.
No, the reason that I read that paper and I thought you had changed your mind is because honestly, the way it phrases the data on olive oil agrees with the data that I've seen. So one passage says there is consistent evidence of beneficial effect of olive oil on cardiovascular risk markers and morbidity and mortality. There's sufficient evidence to recommend its use. This matches the data that I've seen with olive oil and the outcomes. So that's why I was surprised to hear that you're still of the view that no oil, period. But
Oh yeah, no, I'm still of that view. Yes, I think that the data are clear enough.
Okay. I think we've clarified kind of our takes and the data that we've seen. Other types of fat beyond oil. I know you've said no avocados, nuts, no nuts at all. Is that what you recommend? You said no peanut butter.
Well, if I say, if I if from my lips I say that it's okay to have four or five walnuts, that is not what people would hear. Esselstyn now has said that you can have nuts. I have never said that, and I'm not going to say it publicly. No, it's no nuts. See, what the bottom line is for me is that over the years we finally have crystallized a program which is astonishingly effective, and it is so powerful to embark on something that is devious from this, that might threaten these very sick patients. I'm going to have to be wedded to a program that works, but very open-minded, hopefully. To but I'm but I find it very hard for me to bring in something like olive oil when the paper after paper has shown me that it injures endothelial cells.
Just a quick final note, guys, on PREDIMED, which we briefly touched on, just to give you a little bit more information. I went over the details of PREDIMED again to refresh my memory. And yes, they did select participants that had no documented heart disease at baseline. So they couldn't have any history of heart attacks or chest pain, angina, nothing like that. But these were patients also that had to have very high cardiovascular risk. So they had to have either type 2 diabetes or at least three other major risk factors. So things like smoking, hypertension, obesity, dyslipidemia, etc. So if they didn't have type 2 diabetes, they had to have at least three of those. So those were the inclusion criteria. All participants were required to meet them. Then they took all the participants, they split them randomly into three groups. Two were put on Mediterranean diets, one with extra olive oil, one with extra nuts. And the third group was a control group that received a diet where they were supposed to reduce fat to some extent, but not a sharp fat reduction by any means. And they observed less events like heart attacks on the two Mediterranean diet groups. But as Dr. Esselstyn points out, it wasn't an elimination of events by any stretch. There were still plenty of events there, just less than on the control group. So this is a good point. It's important to remember a 30% reduction in risk, that's about what they saw, does not mean an elimination of risk. In fact, if you're eliminating 30% of events, by definition, most of the events are still there. So the trial points to the Mediterranean diet being superior to the control diet for cardiovascular events. It does not show that the Mediterranean diet eliminates all cardiovascular risk or that it handles any other risk factors that are present, as in the case of these participants, or possibly pre-existing plaque from exposure to risk factors over years before the trial started. So hopefully that gives you a bit more context for our conversation. We'll try to have the full interview out as soon as possible. Thanks for watching. I'll see you soon.